So my name is Uzodinma Iwala. I'm the editor-in-chief of Ventures Africa magazine. And I have the pleasure of talking with three distinguished colleagues here about the next generation of philanthropy. Basically, how a younger generation is going to change the way that we give on the continent. So I'm just going to do a quick introduction of everyone, and then I'll quick housekeeping stuff, and then we'll get to work, right? All right, so to my left, your right, is Patrick Ngoi, who's the founder and CEO of the Helvetic Group, which is the fastest growing company in renewable energy in East Africa. He's also the founder of the Light for Life Foundation, which is a non-profit social enterprise that provides free solar energy for women in schools in parts of rural Tanzania. To his left, we have Elizabeth Tanya Masiwa, who has been involved in philanthropy from a very early age. She serves as the advisor on talent and development for long-term engagement at the Higher Life Foundation, and is also a co-founder of Simba Education that deals with early childhood education. And then last but not least, on her left, is Sangudele, who's the chairman and CEO of Golden Palm Investments, which is an investment holding company that funds promising startups that have social impacts and generate jobs. Just so that you get to know your panelists a little bit more, I asked each one of them for a quick funny fact about themselves. And Patrick told me that despite having to climb many things to install solar panels, he has an abject fear of heights, which he has since conquered by going skydiving, right? Elizabeth actually mentioned to me that she had begged her father to work with him for the longest time since she was young. And on her first assignment was actually fired at age 16 by her dad for fainting in the airport. And Sangu told me that when he was 5 years old, he actually proposed to Sister Domitila, right?
Domitila.
Domitila at his Catholic primary school because he was so in love with her. And she told him that, sorry, she was wedded to Jesus. But as we start, what I wanted to do really quickly with you all is just, if you have a second, I know you all have pens and papers, and why don't you just take a moment and answer this question for yourselves. Write it down as we start, which is, what is philanthropy to you, right? And who is a philanthropist? And I ask you that just, you know, so when we get to the questions, you have that on your mind. And I'll now turn to my panelists and throw the question out to them, which is, we're talking about the next generation of philanthropy here on the continent, and should we even really be talking about philanthropy if we're moving to the next generation of how we give and how we shape social activities on the continent? I'll throw it out to you, Patrick.
Let me say first, it's good to be here amongst great philanthropists and our esteemed leaders. Well, I think philanthropy for me is a very bombastic word in the sense that most of the millennials right now, including myself, we really have to look at how is it that we can affect the ecosystem of doing business. And in doing so, you have to look at the people who can afford your product or service, and also look at the ones that can't. So I run a social enterprise, the Light for Life Foundation, which I wouldn't call myself a philanthropist per se, but rather say I am a social entrepreneur and looking at how it is that I can affect those ones who cannot afford our products or services more positively so that they one day can become our clients. And I'll get into that in terms of how I've done
so
it.
So you're saying philanthropy is too bombastic a term, but I know, Sango, that you disagree with that a little bit.
I do, and I think that Patrick is actually a philanthropist. He just doesn't know it. So when we say philanthropy, what does it mean? Let us go to the etymology of the word. Philanthropia in Greek came from the 5th century BC in Prometheus Bound, a play in which Prometheus gave the earliest humans fire and blind hope with which they were then able to change their world. And so philanthropia means love for humanity. And philanthropy as opposed to charity is focused on how do we solve the root problems of social ills. So whether you are using social entrepreneurship as Patrick is, whether you are using business, whether you are using any other model, the purpose of philanthropy is love for humanity. It is the way we've come to understand philanthropy, and it's, you know, now when you think of philanthropy, you basically think of some rich guy putting money in a foundation and going after pet causes he cares about. But if we go to the root of philanthropy, It's love for humanity, which Patrick embodies in his everyday work.
Elizabeth, I see you. Elizabeth, I think you are one of the experienced philanthropists here working with the Higher Life Foundation, so I see you nodding your head at the same time, shaking your head a little bit. So,
I definitely agree with the way that he's defined philanthropy. I define what philanthropy is by my own story. When my parents founded the Higher Life Foundation, my mom had this sort of approach where she decided that she didn't think that it was worth helping somebody if you truly don't understand where they come from or what their daily life is like. So she went to all the orphanages and she would sleep where they slept and ate where they ate. And she often tells the story, but the part of the story she forgets is that I often went along with her. I would go when I could, I would go with her to the orphanages, and a lot of the times, the children that she started to help became my friends. And I think from that experience, I felt a sense of responsibility for people my own age and for my own generation. And that's really how I see what philanthropy is. It's taking on a responsibility to help those who are not as fortunate as you are.
So I see, what I see here from you guys is a desire to move away from this idea of someone kind of an unseen person kind of doling out cash or favors or whatever it is, and more towards an active, engaged understanding of what philanthropy is. But maybe that moves away from just, say, giving things out, more engagement, right? And for our generation, we're talking about a little bit more intimacy in the way, especially here on the continent, in the way that we give. I'm just wondering the work that you guys do. I mean, for example, with the Light of Life Foundation, I mean, can you tell us a little bit about how that works for you, like physically?
What do I say? First, I've been an entrepreneur for half of my life. And we started in 2007, Helvetic Solar. And what it does is we supply, install, and maintain solar systems throughout East Africa. And what we have done is throughout the years, we were the first company in the Northern Circuit of Tanzania to successfully be able to do that. Others had come before us and they'd left. What made us unique was in the sense that we were able to actually look at it in a different context. We instead of waiting for customers to come, we actually wrote proposals. So we went to different ministries and gave them proposals on how they could do it. We went to the United Nations in Arusha as well. We did the whole solar system when they accepted our proposal. So we sort of created our own luck. And we did that successfully from 2007 all the way to 2012. And we really didn't know how good we're doing. I just know that we were able to achieve a seven-figure turnover at the age of 24. Right. But then I just didn't know how we ranked in terms of other businesses.
But then in terms of the sort of getting to the engagement with people, yeah, and why you picked this particular area?
Well, access to energy is a challenge. And I've been listening to so many of the panelists talk here. And they talk of education, they talk of health, they talk of how is it that we can be able to create employment. But one of the biggest challenges that we continuously face in Africa is the lack of energy, access to energy, power. How do you power these things? It starts from a unit level in terms of how do you power one cell phone, right? All the way to the industrial level. And the government has been really slow in terms of how is it that they can
this
embrace.
This is the Tanzanian government.
I would say in an African context. Okay. I think that a lot more could be done. Statistics are sure. We did an interview with the African Progress panel for Kofi Annan, and we were featured there, and we showed what it is that we've done amongst others. And you see that the numbers are really scary. So, and for us, we engaging with the private sector, we didn't know how well we're doing, but we did well because the demand was there. So in 2012, what happened was the KPMG does a mid-sized company survey. Right. We decided to be a part of it, and we were so shocked when we emerged as the top mid-sized company in Tanzania.
So just to shape, you're saying that one of the main issues you said was basically in order to get to people and really affect the way that they live,
yeah,
you need to impact some of the things that they use most, which,
yeah,
would be energy,
yeah,
access,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And so, you know, if we're expanding upon that, we're talking about how do we impact those core areas, right? And I think in each of the work that you're doing, you're each tackling one of these core areas.
Yeah.
So energy for you,
yeah,
and especially I think, you know, really interesting on the renewable side as a way of like impacting the way that people live. But you know, let's throw open to some of our other guests. Like, what other areas do you think, if we're looking at how we redefine how we help, how we shape people's lives on the continent, what other areas should we be looking at as new generation philanthropists?
When you say redefine, it reminds me of, I think, as Africans, we need to think of philanthropy on our own terms. So if I take Christianity, for example, which is a huge force on the continent, we did not take Western Christianity and just drink the bottle. We appropriated it on our own terms. And right from the onset of Christianity, Africans owned and created our own theological interpretations of that Christianity. And we're able to champion it. And today, the center of gravity in Christianity has shifted from the north to the south. And Africa is at this center of the resurgence of the faith. And Africa today is contributing to the salvation of the global Christian community. In that same way, I think it necessitates an appropriation of philanthropy. What does philanthropy mean for us? How do we define it on our own terms? And what is that impact? So for us, one of the things we care a lot about is job creation. How do we solve our local problems in a way that creates jobs? And it's not job creation because it's a buzzword and people like to hear it. In 2050, in the next 35 years, 1 billion Africans are going to be born. Our population will be 2.4 billion. We don't have a choice. There is an urgency. If we do not create jobs for 60% of the world's global youth, that will be in sub-Saharan Africa, we risk going back to the 70s where we had strife and conflict. So there's an urgency.
I think I just have to say that, you know, both of the panelists here have really started to define what it means to be the next generation. When you're the next generation, you go against the status quo. And I think they're really defining what us as Africans are. This generation has become extremely uncomfortable with what we've seen. I know in the last generation, we waited for foreign aid, we waited for donors, and we really waited for philanthropy, you know, the way the old guard sort of define it, where you give dollars towards causes that you're passionate about. But I think that, you know, nature of being uncomfortable with what we see is what drives the areas in which we've decided, you know, to tackle. So I think that this generation is not necessarily about, do you target infrastructure or do you go for water? I think it's about creating innovative solutions to some of the problems that we each face in our sphere of contact. So I would rather, that's how I would really answer the question that you posed. And I think both of these panelists have sort of said something along the same lines.
So to the old guard, don't stop giving money. But, you know, just think about it a little differently. But I know Patrick, that you have some interesting ideas on sort of what's been said about the acceptance of donor aid and how that has shaped the way that we essentially view ourselves. So I'm wondering if you might comment on that.
Well, I think it's important to really look at what is it that donor aid has done and how much of it has been given over the years and the impact that it has had. I mean, there's so many reports that are quite scary in terms of how the performance has been. So I think right now it's the idea that President Obama has been going and making Africa sort of embrace in terms of partnership, and which is also part of the Sustainable Development Goals, I think is a really good approach in terms of how is it that Africa will actually work in a much more dignified manner, whereby we look at how is it that we can collaborate and form partnerships so that it's more of a for-profit, right? But at the same time, come up with those innovative solutions that will also be able to sort of get us from address all the challenges that our societies and communities face.
Sango, I'm wondering if what you have to...
Yeah, a few quick points. One, I think, is, look, that we need to move away from what I call vain philanthropy, where big ticket item is done for PR, and we know. We in this room, we know what we are talking about when we say this. And towards philanthropy that's focused on actually solving the problems and focused on results. If you talk to Titi, you know she cares about the education stuff, and it's beyond just PR. She really fundamentally cares about having an impact. You look at Patrick with Ashesi University, who's in his integrity and his commitment to excellence is unparalleled. That is the type of philanthropy we need to do. But the only two quick things I'll add is we need to focus on the beneficiaries. None of us in this room really understand what it's like to be at the bottom of the pyramid. And if we started that way, we've forgotten. Yet, who is representing the voice of the poor and the structurally oppressed? We surely are not. So we need to make sure as we think about impact and we think about where our efforts are going towards, the voice of those we purport to serve must be at the decision-making table.
Right. I mean, I think it's a very good point. I'll talk to that. My question is, I mean, should that stop us, though, if they're not at the table? Should that stop us from trying to figure out what we should be doing? I mean, there are definitely two sides of the conversation, obviously, right? But, I mean, if those people are not at the table, right, which it's very true that they're not, I mean, how do we then determine what we should be doing, what areas we should be focusing on?
We don't have an excuse now with technology. The farmer line guy was talking about how he's using SMS phones to get in touch with farmers. We now have 1 billion mobile subscribers. We can use SMS to get in touch with people at the bottom of the pyramid. So I don't think we have an excuse. But I think we need to be open-minded about how we go about it. Take healthcare, for example. We have 11% of global population in sub-Saharan Africa, 26% of global disease burden, and only 3% of healthcare workers. Yet, when we are trying to build in Golden Palm, we're building a chain of healthcare clinics to make a difference here, and the non-profit sector will say, because we're a for-profit model, this doesn't make sense. We can't afford to be putting artificial boundaries when we have 3% of healthcare workers. It won't work.
Right.
I mean, I agree with that notion, but I sort of see it in a different way. You know, more than 3 billion people in the world today live on less than $2.50 a day. That's probably the bottles of water we'll drink today. And I think that the solutions that we have right now need to become more effective. And I think the only way to really come up with sustainable solutions is to include those people, those 3 billion people, which represent more than half of the world's population, to be a part of the solution. And the only way to do that is to really for them to be, you know, part of the discussion, and for also for them to be empowered in a different way, which brings about, you know, social entrepreneurship. I personally believe that in the next decades to come, philanthropy will be defined as social entrepreneurship.
So let's further break down social entrepreneurship. What exactly is that to you?
So social entrepreneurship is a business whose mission-driven. I don't believe that you should use, you should isolate business and the way that you address social issues. I think that business rigorous principles need to be applied when we tackle social issues. And so it's a business that is mission-driven, meaning that where businesses measure profit as a measure of success, we measure impact, we measure sustainability, and we measure the effect of the solution that we've come up with.
I think Patrick, you had to.
Sango is a good friend of mine, so I'll have to differ with his take. And you see, the biggest problem that I see, and actually being in forums like this, is we always try to really look at things at a macro level. You know, statistics, numbers, 3%, 1 billion, 2.4. That sounds nice, but the reality is when you come on the ground is what are you doing as an individual in order to make a difference? Because it starts with you, and then setting that example so that you can actually have people supporting your initiative. Let me tell you what we did. When Helvetic Solar, we knew, okay, we're doing well, and we decided now we were launching a new product. So I was hearing a lot about D-Light, yeah, and so we compete with D-Light. We make our own product, it's made in China. I source it from China because I studied there, and it's interesting because when we brought it down onto the ground and we got the consultants to see how is it that we can be able to take this product into the market, they came up to us with proposals of doing billboards. They told us to do TV ads, very nice and fancy. And then the budget for which was really in the thousands and thousands of dollars. I stood back and I said, no, I think this is the wrong approach. Why don't we actually take our product into the marketplace? The amount that we're supposed to use in sort of advertising this product, set up a foundation, take this product, put it into the marketplace, give users who really need to have, and they don't pay for it. Now, we also looked at it in sense, now how do we make it sustainable? We looked for women and young people and schools, dispensaries, who needed the light. So we gave them the product to use free of charge. But then in return, we were always trying to get the feedback. How has it boosted their business? How has it made life better for them? And in that process, we ended up supporting those ones in the ecosystem who couldn't afford to buy the product. But at the same time, a big transformation took place. Our numbers started coming in terms of sales. Mm. Because the feedback from the same rural clientele that used the product meant that the next person came back to us and said, no, we are ready to buy for it. They saved up.
Right.
And we didn't have to do any fancy billboards and so forth. And so that's why I think it's important to really now look at it at a micro level. What are you really doing as a business? And that's why for me, I say, if I call myself a philanthropist, it's bombastic in the sense that you look at how it is that you can get into the ecosystem in a way that is sustainable, so you cut expenses somewhere else so that you can do something that is proactive.
Right. Elizabeth, you're nodding. Is that an example of social entrepreneurship for you?
It is. And I think that you're humanizing it a lot more. Sometimes when you talk about philanthropy, it's very difficult to resonate with people that are admired most for their philanthropic work. Your Bill Gates, your Warren Buffett, they have so much money. And sometimes, especially when you're the next generation and you're younger, it's very difficult to find your place in that space. But, you know, with what you said, at High Life Foundation, you know, in any given year, we have about an average of 30,000 children on the program. And we realize the importance of having to know each and every one of the children that are there. So we launched a program called Know Your Flock. And we went out to get to know each and every child. And at the time, we had over 40,000 children. So you can imagine the amount of work that went into that. And we realized that young people who are living at what we define as the bottom of the pyramid, they're hungry to be a part of the solution. And when you get to know them and you get to understand that, you know, they're not comfortable in their situation either. They want a solution where they can also better their own lives. They want to come out of poverty as well. That's when we were able to develop different programs to engage with them. And at the moment, we have every Saturday online, we have a program that we call Young and Dynamic. And we just have panel discussions where we discuss issues like politics, social entrepreneurship, introducing them to the ideas that we've been exposed to. And every Saturday, we have in excess of 600 people, well, you know, between the age of high school and tertiary, logging on. And this is in Zimbabwe, where right now we have an electricity issue. But that doesn't stop them, because they want to know what it is that makes, you know, us have the lives that we have, and they want to know how they can be a part of it.
So let me. Sango, I think Patrick and Elizabeth have directly challenged your tossing out of some statistics. So what do you have to say to that?
So, Patrick is a good friend. Look, I agree with that at the micro level, but I think, again, let's not create artificial boundaries between micro and macro, because the micro needs to roll up and build up to the macro. So, and when you look at the macro issue, at the same time, you need to figure out how do you implement it on the micro. Take an issue, for example, that has been a big thorn in my flesh, and that is gender equality on the continent. When I'm finishing a book on young entrepreneurs across Africa, I went to 43 African countries, interviewed 600 plus entrepreneurs. And at the end of the journey, I realized that Africa, we have a problem in creating barriers for female entrepreneurs. We have a problem. And it is timely that we're in Kigali, Rwanda, because Rwanda is setting the record for the world in terms of, you know, women empowerment. We see that in the participation rates across the board. Yes. Okay, Rwanda has done that. Who has emulated? And how do we look internally at our businesses? If you say you're for women's empowerment, what are you doing within your businesses? Look at your board, look at your management. Internally, what have you done? So we really need to make sure at a micro level we're not just speaking the talk, but we're doing the action as well.
I just wanted to say there isn't gender equality on this panel.
I can leave if there's anybody else who wants to moderate. No, but I think it's true. It's a big thing. And the question is, so how do we bundle that and how do we wrap that so that we're not sort of separating issues, so that we're not separating that from, you know, what we need to do, I guess, as new generation philanthropists or as people are thinking about how we redefine this concept? I don't know, I'll toss that out to you guys there. I mean, Sango, you started with saying that we really need to reshape, but what are some of the concrete things that we can do? So
I think Elizabeth already touched on some of that, which is saying that don't think of business in one box and impact in another box. One of the things we've done is, look, the African rising narrative, we know that 6 of the 10 fastest growing economies are in sub-Saharan Africa. You go across the continent, we are growing. Yes, there's economic growth. But do we have shared prosperity? So what we've done internally has said, we're going to make sure every employee, from a cleaner to a manager, has equity in the business. So that if we end up building a $1 billion enterprise, it is not only investors that do well, but the cleaner who is shining the window, who is contributing in his small way to your success, also benefits. So we have a unique opportunity to look at the West and see the inequality that's happening now in the US and in Europe, and to say, how do we appropriate capitalism on our own terms? How do we appropriate it based on our culture and make sure that the African growth story will not leave women behind and will not leave the bottom of the pyramid behind?
Right. Patrick, I'm wondering what you think.
Well, again, Sangood has a lot of macro level, so I'm happy to have been one of the people that he interviewed me and I'm featured in his book, and we met about 2.5 years ago. And what I do believe, he's spot on. I think it's important to really address how is it that you can have inclusive growth. And for us, what we've done, I'm fortunate in the sense that I was, my journey into entrepreneurship came as a result of being empowered by my mother. So I have a soft spot for women. And in our nonprofit, what we have done is we target women. And I'm happy to say now we have provided solar solutions to over 1,635 women. And in return, I think it's actually giving opportunities for those. So I will, again, look at it at a micro level in the sense that that's what we have done. And I believe that inclusive growth is how is it that you can be able to get people onto the table who are not necessarily get all those privileges and they're disenfranchised.
Right. I want to turn the conversation a little bit. So we've been talking, you know, in broader terms, and I want to go to this. I think, Sango, you brought up a couple of names, but if we're talking about folks that we think about as redefining the philanthropic space, you know, on this panel, I think we all know a number of people and have interacted with a number of people, and I'm wondering if you guys could throw out for our audience, and I guess amongst yourselves, some of the people who you think are reshaping. I mean, Sango, you started, but you know, Patrick and Elizabeth, what other folks do you think that we should be looking at as people who we can who can help us rethink this space?
Well, I've looked at a number of case studies, but obviously Muhammad Yunus got a Nobel Prize for his efforts in social entrepreneurship or social business. And he really was able to empower women to farm and to be able to get a livelihood for their own families. But one, you know, company that I thought was a little bit interesting is one called Aravind, and they do eye surgeries in India. And they've come up with an interesting pricing model where they charge more to wealthier customers per se, and they're able to give people really at the bottom of the pyramid the same quality of surgery. Now I know there's a lot of, you know, controversy around charging people who can pay more a lot more to give, you know, services at the bottom. But if you look at the impact that they've managed to achieve through that pricing model, it's astounding. And I don't think that there's one solution that we can look at and say, okay, this is what I'm gonna follow. I think that, you know, we should watch the space, because I think this next generation is gonna be the example that we set. Right. For the generation to come.
So Muhammad Yunus and Aravind, Sango, you've got a couple I think that you want to...
Yes. I think deeply about how do we create catalytic change where there's a multiplier impact. So it's not just one change in a vacuum, but that change can then unlock others. And the name that comes to mind is David Senge at MIT's Media Lab. David grew up in Sierra Leone and saw what happened during the Civil War. Went to Harvard and MIT for his PhD and started designing. He designed prosthetic limbs for Civil War survivors. And they are the most comfortable limbs that are fitted, thinking about how most of the people who invented the limbs, they don't know what the experience is like. But David knew firsthand what it was like to experience, you know, for his, he had family members who had experienced the negative elements of the war. So he designed these prosthetic limbs. But on top of that, he said, I'm one person designing these limbs. How do I create an opportunity for lots of Africans to do the same? So he started the Innovate program that's now in Sierra Leone, Kenya, and all over Africa, of getting high school students to come up with engineering solutions and to create things. And he then discovered Kelvin Doe, the 14 or 16-year-old Sierra Leonean who became the youngest visiting lecturer at MIT, because he, from rubbish heap, he designed a radio. So those are the types of initiatives we need to support. That which can unleash this catalytic growth and transformation.
My take is I would like to applaud the African women as a class. I wouldn't really point out any individual. Why? Because being inspired by my own mother who enabled me to be where I am today, and also hearing the story of the resilience that African women have to rise up to and to so many challenges in their community. They fetch firewood, they fetch water, they raise the kids, and it's such a challenge. And they are an example of human nature at its best. So for me, I really look up to African women as the pioneers for tomorrow, and we should definitely empower them.
Right. So, you know, so then again, to sort of move out, we also touched on this a little bit, but can we talk a little bit about specific areas? So we mentioned energy access, we mentioned job creation. What other areas, and this is also to toss out to you, my friends in the audience, some of the specific areas that you think in terms of next generation. I'm not going to ask you to say them yet, but just think of them in your head. But my friends up here, what do you think? Energy access, we talked about a little bit. What other areas should we be looking at as new generation philanthropists where we can have a real impact?
Education. Well, I'm a strong believer in education. Nelson Mandela said the most powerful weapon to change the world is, to change the world and to also reduce poverty is education. I feel, you know, in the need to invest in people. I think that when you invest in people, you deal with a lot of the social problems that we face today. If you educate a woman, she's more likely to invest in healthcare for her children. She's more likely to raise the next generation of leaders. So I really think that education is essential to take Africa to the next level. Obviously, High Life Foundation is focused on education, but with my friends, I was able to found Simba Education, which focuses on early childhood education. 95% of a child's brain development happens between 0 and 3, and those first 1,000 days really define a child's life. So, I felt that early childhood education was essential for primary school and even secondary school to be as successful, since there's a lot of investment going into it. So I don't know if there's any other areas.
Yeah, I agree. Education is definitely very important. But it's also, what do we do after they've graduated? How do we create economic opportunities for young people after they get their education? Madiba and the Nkrumahs and Kenyattas and the like have done a tremendous job of creating political freedom for us as a continent. But the political freedom is meaningless if we don't have economic freedom. Mm. So how do we create economic opportunities and scale it? Three things I'll quickly highlight. One is scale. We simply need to be able to scale across the continent. I think Bright Simmons mentioned this yesterday, and that we have to think Pan-African. And we have to achieve this through innovative collaborations between academia, nonprofits, private sector. Second thing is, and I'm sorry, I'm going to call out the old guards. We need to support young people in a meaningful way. It's sad and unfortunate that with all the stuff I've done, I've received more support outside Africa than within Africa. We need to support our own. And we need to make sure that as we come up with these initiatives, we raise and mentor. Silicon Valley is not Silicon Valley by accident. There's this intergenerational mentorship that has allowed people to succeed. And we need mentorship. And we need the old guys to make sure that they reach back and they pull us up and support us in our efforts. And the third and final thing, which we never want to talk about, but I don't think we can succeed if we don't tackle it, is governance. In the same way we are calling for entrepreneurs in the private sector, we need public sector entrepreneurs also. If only we had a Shesi graduate in our government, we wouldn't have the problems we have today.
So which brings me to sort of one more point before we turn it out to the audience for questions for you guys. Which is, okay, so if we're building this new idea of philanthropy, what are the tools that you guys need to succeed, that others in your position would need to actually make this happen?
Well, on my take is, it's entrepreneurship, whether social or serial or engaged in philanthropy as well, it comes from a place of passion, right? So you have to, because the challenges are enormous, and once you get into it, you actually come and find out things that you didn't anticipate. So what I would say as an important tool is to find something that you are, you know, hearing my fellow panelists speak, they're clearly, they're passionate about what it is that they're doing. We are passionate about clean tech. So in clean tech, we have been able to make leapfrog in so many ways because we are passionate about it. So I think it's an important thing to really have in that passion, that drive, so that you can that will overcome all those challenges that you get along the lines.
So passion.
Yeah.
Elizabeth, I know we talked about in social entrepreneurship metrics.
Yeah, exactly. I feel that young people need opportunities, and there are a lot of people in the room that I've met that are giving young people opportunities in terms of investment. But unless we have standards on how to measure the impact of your investment, it's not going to be as attractive to people who maybe don't believe in social issues to invest in young people. So I think we need to develop strong matrices to be able to measure the impact of your investment to make social business or investing in young people more attractive.
Right. And Sangu?
I'm going to appeal to scripture, 1 Timothy 4:12. Do not let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in faith, in love, and in purity. Going back to my appeal today, I'm going to use scripture to beg the old guards that we really, really need partnership and collaboration between the young and the old, because it is very difficult, from access to capital, to networks, to being given a shot. If we can create a field where the old guard bring us in and we can work together, we can create a more hopeful Africa, where my dream is that my grandchildren will look at the May 11, 2000 cover of The Economist that called us the hopeless continent and say, Daddy, Granddaddy, were they on drugs?
With that, let me turn it open to the audience. I'll give the floor to you all to ask questions to our wonderful panelists. I'm going to ask that you actually ask a question to the panelists, so I will cut you off. I'm just giving you warning if it's not a question. So do we have microphones? I think we have the first I saw in the green back here, so if we can get a mic over. And if you wouldn't mind introducing yourself as you ask your question.
Thank you very much. My name is Laurence de Nerveau from Fondation de France. And as one of our colleagues said last night, this is a question I've been meaning to ask for since the beginning of the forum. So this is my chance, and I think it's the good moment to ask it. My question is, and it is a question,
yeah,
is how much importance do you give to the issue of the environment? Because I think it was not very much addressed in this forum, and of course it is a very transversal issue, so it's okay not to have a
right
specific panel dedicated to it, but you know,
so
obviously
let me just,
that...
Let me put
yeah,
it
yeah,
together.
Just
so
I think it's critical to all the issues we address, actually, whether
right
it be education, health, agriculture, even entrepreneurship.
Right.
So you also mentioned clean tech, but I think it's a question that's
right
critical to the next generation, and you know we're hosting in Paris the COP21
conference. Okay, so I'm going to stop you right there, and
next
I'm going to turn it
that's
to them.
It.
So
thank you.
Climate change, environment, I think, you know, as was asked, which is a very important question. Patrick, why don't you handle that? Since
great question, and I'll be in Paris in December. In Tanzania, what has happened is United Nations Global Compact is launched, and I was selected as the chairperson. And what our focus has been now is to get multinationals on board into embracing two things that we've regarded as Principle 7 to Principle 10, and that is related to environment and anti-corruption. And I'll be heading that, so look out for that. But also as well, I feel as it's always important to get multinationals on the table when it comes to addressing situations involving environment. I'm very passionate about that because we're in clean tech. And what we do is we believe that those big polluters are the ones that we should actually be talking to, because if you zero in on that, then you can make drastic changes. A big worry that I have is right now we talk of the Syria and Afghan crisis, whereby it's caused the migration and refugees caused of war. But Elon Musk said it best when he said, if we have climate change refugees, people moving from one place to another because the climate is uninhabitable, that's actually going to be a big, big problem. And Africa stands at a very bad position in terms of that. So I think it's an important subject, it's an ongoing discussion. So I think what's most important is just to get the right people on the table and get the dialogue going, and such forums make a huge difference.
Sangha.
Two quick points. One is, look, I definitely, I'll be honest, growing up, I thought this environment thing is a bunch of hippies talking about green stuff. We in Africa, what is this environment? We want to get food for people in a clean environment. But then I grew up, I learned, I became educated. I went glacier hiking in Iceland, and it shook me to the core, because I literally saw the caps melting. And I realized, look, we're going to have a problem. That said, you and I have that luxury to do that. I'm a Sewa in the village. How can she relate to that? So I think we need to think about how we communicate it and stop this sitting on a moral high horse, preaching to Africans saying care about the environment. We really need to make sure that we engage in a conversation with them and make it appropriate and culturally relevant that people can understand. So there's buy-in, and it's not just this imposed thing. The second thing is there's a cost to it. There's an economic cost. We looked at if we were to do emission standards for vehicles in Ghana, for example, the cost of each vehicle will go up by $2,000. When per capita income is at $3,000, what does that do? What does that mean? So we need to really think about this and realize that, look, the West has polluted its way to $50,000 per capita GDP. And now it's turning to us and saying, hey, guys, catch up to us. But we have to be fair and say, who is going to pay for it? There's a cost to it. So, look, I'm very much committed to the environmental cause. But I think, A, it has to be done in a way that engages Africans in a very real way and in a respectful way. And B, we have to address this real issue of economic distortions in the market.
Elizabeth, do you want to add to that? Or do you?
No.
Okay. I'll go right here with this gentleman. Glasses on your head.
Thank you. I have a question.
Okay.
But I also have three children your age, and I'm really, really impressed by what I've heard today. And the three speakers just before, there's a future for Africa. But we need 1 million of you. So my question to each of you is, how do you replicate yourself?
Uh-oh.
How do we...
I think if there's ever an endorsement,
how do we spark this desire, this curiosity, this passion, this vision at the age of 10? How right. do we leverage education systems? How do we leverage philanthropy, since we're in a philanthropy? Because the answer for Africa, and I'm a very proud African, is that we need at least 1 million of you.
Okay, so I'll turn
I'm
it.
Really, me, really impressed. Thank
let
you.
Let me, first of all, round of applause to you guys. Second of all, okay, so, and I'll start with you, Elizabeth. How do you replicate yourself? What's the secret?
Well, I have to give credit to my parents.
Okay.
yeah, can we clap for them?
Yes. Yeah.
you know, my dad, you know, sometimes gives these long lectures, and we've tried everything from pretending to sleep to trying to be on your phone. I guess he knows everything in terms of the excuses, so he just keeps going. And I guess as I got older, I started to appreciate it a little bit more. And one day he was talking, you know, giving, he likes to tell stories. So he was telling stories about something that had happened in one of his business ventures. And I thought, you know, more people need to hear about this. And I didn't know at the time, but some of his staff members had approached him and said, can you write a blog? And he was like, out of the question. So I went to him and I said, can we open a Facebook account? And on my way there, everyone was like, he'll never say yes, never. And he said, okay, so how does this work? So we opened the Facebook account and we did our first post. And he thought it was pretty cool. We did the second post. And he was now checking every day to see how many likes. Now he has over 1 million likes, we get reminded, in just over a year. And he's giving just little short articles, giving entrepreneurial advice. And it has really changed the way that young Africans see business. I've been so surprised at the impact that it's caused. So he recently went to my sister's parent-teacher thing, and I said, so were there any celebrity parents there? And he says, me. So I asked why, my sister said, oh, that Facebook page.
So you're saying that it's in terms of projecting people, you're taking examples from people you know, your father, for example, but saying projecting that out to a younger generation, helping us shape who we are is one of the ways of
so
of
that they can forward. Draw from the same lessons.
Right.
Yeah.
Patrick?
For me, I think, let me point out two things that are very obvious. Again, I'll zero in micro level, right? African Philanthropy Forum, the fact that there's such a panel, I think they deserve an applause.
We'll do that.
You, with Ventures Africa, I know I've done several interviews on your website, and it's doing amazing stuff. What I believe is we should the African story should be told, and it should be told right, and it should be told by Africans, right? So if that story is heard, it can go a long way, long after we are gone. And that is the game changer. If we wait for the West to come and report stories about what Patrick Ngoi is doing, it's very different from the way Ventures Africa reports. So I think that story should be told, and such forums should be not only at the African Philanthropy Forum, it should also go to the Global Philanthropy Forum, whereby we can actually tell our story on our own, get asked the questions and respond. And that is when the game changing begins.
Right. Yeah. So it's projecting the story again, setting that example. Yeah. And Sangha.
I was at the Harvard Yale game. President Drew Faust had a brunch where all the buildings and flesh were there. And this old donor, whose family had supported Harvard for generations, as I told him my story, and he said, "So if you hadn't come to Harvard, do you think you'd be where you are?" And I said, "Yes, because I would have gone to Ashesi." Now, I say this seriously. If sometimes in the, when I'm in the shower, I think, what if I win the lottery for $1 billion? What would I do with it? If I had $1 billion and let's say I was about to die, I literally, and I'm not joking, I would go to Patrick and say, "Patrick, here's $1 billion, replicate Ashesi." And the reason I say this, and I keep on promoting Ashesi, is I've seen it. I've hired Ashesi graduates, and I've seen the difference. I know the problems we have with our educational system, and I've seen how in 4 years, the curriculum they have, the culture they've created, emerges a crop of ethical, unapologetic, entrepreneurial graduates who are ready to take on the world and create a new Africa. So if we want to create sustained transformation and create a million of us, talk to Patrick, and let's figure out how we can expand what he's doing.
There we go.
From your lips to God's ears, may you get a billion.
Amen. We'll take another question. We'll go way in the back. Actually, we'll go to the front table here.
I think we also need to hear your story. What's your story?
My... Yes.
So should I do the moderation? Now?
Sure. We can
please tell us about your journey.
No, but I mean, if we're talking about that, now you guys have put me on the spot. But I'll say a little bit. But I really do think it is it's an example thing, and I think that's been said a number of times. But I mean, I happen to have really wonderful parents as well, who I think have always pushed for. You know, it's never good enough is never good enough. It's always take it to the next level. And I think, you know, in terms of some of the things I've done, whether it's the writing or medicine, you know, or even coming back to Nigeria to try and sort of start this magazine, Ventures Africa, it's always been about how can you take it to the next level? How can you set, and as you're doing that, how can you set an example for, you know, people who are coming after you? And I think, you know, to the gentleman's question earlier, I think for all of us right up on this panel, that's one of the main things, is how can you be an example, and how can you use what previous examples have shown you to sort of inform and shape discussion for another set of people. I mean, I hope that's what we're all doing. I think that's what we are. But now that you've put me on the spot a little embarrassed, I'm going to quickly go to another question. And we're going to go to the back there. Eddie, in the back.
Eddie Mandrew, at Yale University. Thank you for a really, really interesting panel. Yesterday, Sisi Masio made a salient point that to be African is to be generous. There's a lot of African diaspora outside of Africa. Next year, they project to send $40 billion in remittances. What do you think we could be doing in terms of leveraging that capital that's, you know, nowadays, you know, you send money, you don't know what happens to it, but everyone is sending money back. Is there something that we can do to figure out how that can be deployed in a more effective way?
So how do remittances reshape the way that we do philanthropy?
Stangu?
Patrick, my dear friend. Well, the first thing I'll say is that 40 billion, Western Union is probably taking 4 billion. So we really need, seriously, if you look at the money transfer, the highest rates are when money is going to Africa. So we need to disrupt that model and come up with more, you know, whether it's using, taking M-Pesa. Is Bob still in the room? He might have to think about models in which we can take M-Pesa and maybe integrate it into the money payment systems. But at a broader level, I think it is time for people in the diaspora to expand their vision of philanthropy. So too often, our philanthropy is within our network. I do a lot of water and sanitation projects, and I was interviewed on TV in Ghana, and I remember the woman saying, but why are you in Ayensuanu? Your father is not from there, your mother is not from there. We still have this idea that if I want to help someone, I'll help my village or my hometown. But I think if we can think more broadly and understand that by pooling our capital in the diaspora, can you imagine if that $40 billion was in one mega fund, for example, and that was used to create change at scale? We could be more powerful by leveraging those dollars at scale. Mm-hmm. So,
Elizabeth, you were nodding.
Well, I was going to throw the question to you, actually, because you're an example of someone who went back home after being educated abroad. So do you want to take it?
What? This is not what I signed up for. I think, you know, in terms of remittances, and I think this is actually a good point, that it's not just capital, it's also about talent, right? It's about human capacity. And I think, again, for me, the decision to come back was pretty simple. My family was there, and then also, I think for me, the idea of a transformed Nigeria was super seductive. And I think, again, for all of us, whether it's that you left and came back, you were born abroad and you've come back, or you've stayed, but the idea of a transformed environment, right, is one in which really calls. And I think, you know, for people sending money back to relatives, right, whether it's, you know, better yourself in this way, here's a little something to make ends meet, here's something for healthcare, for energy, or whatever, or whether it's I'm coming back and I'm trying to bring the skills that I have to reshape. I think we've talked a lot about Ashesi University and some of the other programs. It's like, let me bring those skills back and reshape the environment and the context in which we operate. I mean, I think that is a profound thing. I think, you know, what you guys are doing at Yale, right, in terms of getting people to come out and then making sure that people come back is also, you know, an interesting and important part of this puzzle. Patrick.
Well, again, I'll zero in the sense that I believe that we should actually leverage what we call the networks. So those ones who are in the diaspora should actually be aware of what is actually happening on the ground and be very well connected with what's going on the ground so that whatever they do send back can be used right and make a difference. Because in Africa, when you have a small amount and you do send it, it can really make a big difference if it's used right. But you need to know who it is that you send it to, so you need to have really leveraged the network. And social media is one, but then, of course, more and more networks need to be formed along those lines.
Great. I know that there are more questions. You guys are going to have to hold those, find our panelists at lunch. I have just a couple of announcements before we end, and then I'm going to ask you guys to sort of summarize, give us, you know, your few key points before everybody leaves. But first and foremost is there are surveys on your tables, which if you have a second, please take those and just fill those out so that we can all help to shape how we do panels going forward. The second thing is that also lunch is going to be at 12, lunch will be downstairs, right? That's correct? Oh, lunch will be here. Forgive me, and at 12:30, so you can take a short break and come back into this room for lunch. And then the last thing is, we also just really wanted to thank the First Lady for being here with us, for engaging with us at the forum and on this panel. Thank you very much, ma'am. I would just ask that as we finish up, if we could all remain seated as she leaves, and then, you know, after the First Lady has exited, then we can all get up and move out. But before that happens, I just want to turn it over to our panelists again and just say, we've had a great discussion for about an hour here. We've had some really good audience questions. What are the two or three key points that you want our audience to leave with as they walk out and then come back in here for lunch? Sangu, we'll start with you since we...
Sure. Just three key points again. One is going back to Bright's point yesterday about thinking Pan-African and thinking of scale in all that we do. The second is, again, I'm going to keep driving this point, which is, old guards, we really need you to support young entrepreneurs and their young success stories. It's critical. And the third is, we need to, whether it's philanthropy or entrepreneurship or whatever it is, we need to appropriate it on our own terms as Africans. And we need to beware of the embedded ethnocentrism and androcentrism in all these things. Thank you.
All right. Elizabeth.
I would just make a comment and say, I think that the best way moving forward for each and every one of us who wants to make a difference is to really take a human-centered design approach, where we come up with solutions that are best fitted for the people that we're helping. Another thing that I, you know, would want to say is that there's a preacher who defined success as the ability to identify a need and reach out to meet that need. And I would just appeal to, you know, to all of us sitting here that I think that maybe that's the way that we should define success, you know, in our own lives, so that one day when we look back, how we define success is the amount of impact we were able to cause in our various initiatives. And yeah, thank Patrick. You.
Well, I have one point. I believe a lot of African youth are doing a lot of remarkable stuff. And what I see as the biggest challenge and what I think people should take away here is find ways in which you can sustainably invest in youth. Because we have the numbers, we have the energy, and we are the future. And if we are looking for a brighter Africa with endless possibilities, you have to look into the youth.
There we have it. So to our panelists, I want to say thank you very much for your time and for your thoughts. To the audience, I want to say thank you for your participation and for your questions. And a round of applause for everyone.